All right, Michael, you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, what's the answer? Walk me through.
I will walk you through. All right, so let's do this. Let's write the Euclidean distance. Well, let's write the Manhattan distance because I don't want to take square roots in my head.
Okay.
Let's write the Manhattan distances next to the x's.
Okay.
Or the y's. All right. Either way.
Let's do it next to the x's. So this is the Manhattan distance, or MD, as the cool kids call it.
Is that true?
Yeah.
I thought the cool kids called it L1.
No. Have you ever heard a cool kid ever say something like L1?
Well, to me, the cool kids are the people at NIPS who know more math than I do. Yeah. Do you think any of them are going to watch this video?
Actually, I'm afraid all of them are going to watch this video.
Now I'm really afraid.
Mm-hmm, so you better get it right. Everyone's watching.
All right. Well, let me compute the Manhattan distances. So the first one, what you do is you take the 1 minus 4,
mm-hmm.
and that's 3, and you take the 6 minus 2, and that's 4, and you add those two together, and you get 7, which, interestingly, is the same as y, but I think that's a coincidence.
Okay. So Manhattan distance is
7. Yeah, and now I'll do all the rest of them because I pre-computed them. 4, 6, 8, 4, 6. All right, so now we've got it set up so we can do 1 and 3 nearest neighbor relatively quickly. So the 1 nearest neighbor, the closest distance, is 4.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, there are two points that have that, 2 comma 4 and 7 comma 1.
Mm-hmm.
They have outputs of 8 and 50 because they almost agree with each other.
Uh-huh.
Not. And if we take the average of those two things, we get 29.
Yep. That is correct, Michael.
Great. Now, in terms of the 3 nearest neighbors, we have the 4s and the 6s.
Mm.
So there's 4 3 nearest neighbors.
Yep.
Somewhat awkwardly. And then we have the average of those things, which is what? 8 and 50 and 16 and 68, which gets us 35.5.
Right. Obviously. Okay. All right. So that was pretty straightforward. And those answers aren't too far off from one another. So what about the Euclidean case?
All right. So one thing to point out, I was worried about computing square roots, but it occurs to me that I actually don't have to compute square roots because that's a monotonic transformation, and we only care about the orders.
Mm. Okay.
So for Euclidean distance, or as I like to call him casually, Ed,
mm-hmm.
we can just take the square differences summed up.
Okay. So this would be Ed squared.
Yes, it would be Ed squared.
Okay, Ed.
Good. So the first one, it'll be the 1 minus 4 is 3, squared is 9, and the 6 minus 2 is 4, squared is 16, and 9 plus 16 is 25. So the first one will be 25.
I noticed the square root of 25 is pretty easy to compute.
Yeah, but the other ones aren't going to be. It just so happens that we've got a Pythagorean triple on our hands.
Mm, I love those.
All right, so the remaining ones, the Ed squareds, are 8, 26, 40, 10, and 20.
Hmm. None of those are easily square rootable.
Exactly. Though 40 feels like it really was trying and failed.
Yeah.
And 8 overshot, and now it's a perfect cube. So 8 is the smallest distance.
Yep.
And again, seemingly coincidentally, the y value associated with that is 8.
Hmm.
So, and 8 is our answer.
Good. And that's correct.
All right. And the 3 closest are 8, 10, and 20.
Mm-hmm.
And if we average the y values for those, that's 8, 50, and 68, which gives us an average of 42. Ah, the meaning of life, the universe, and pretty much everything.
Yes, and that is absolutely correct. So that's kind of cool that you get completely different answers depending upon what you do.
Yeah, it does seem very different, doesn't it? I mean, there's like several orders of magnitude spread here.
Well,
maybe not orders of magnitude, but orders of doubling.
Yes, there are orders of doubling spread. Well, you know what, Michael? I actually had a specific function in mind when I did this.
Okay, let's find out which one is the right one.
Well, the function I had was y was equal to the first dimension squared plus the second dimension. So let's call those x1 and x2. And this was actually the function that I had in place. So you square the first term and you add the second one.
Okay, and so like looking at the second to last one, for example, 7 squared is 49 plus 1 is 50. Oh, that's
mm-hmm.
cool.
Yeah.
It's very consistent.
Thank you. So what would be the actual answer for 4 comma 2?
Okay, so 4 squared is 16 plus 2 is 18, which is close to none of them.
Right. So there's a lesson here. There are several lessons here. And one lesson I don't want you to take away. So here's the lesson. So I actually had a real function here. There was no noise. It was fairly well represented. The proper answer was 18, and basically none of these are right. But the first thing I want you to notice is you get completely different answers depending upon exactly whether you do 1 versus 3, whether you do Euclidean versus Manhattan. And that's because these things make assumptions about your domain that might not be particularly relevant. And this sort of suggests that maybe this thing doesn't do very well. KNN doesn't do very well because none of these are close to 18. That seems a little sad. But I've got good news for you, Michael.
Okay.
The good news is that actually KNN tends to work really, really well, especially given its simplicity. It just doesn't in this particular case, and there's really a reason for that. And it has to do with the sort of fundamental assumptions and bias of KNN. I happen to pick an example that sort of violates some of that bias. So I think it's worthwhile to take a moment to think about what the preference bias is for KNN, and to see if that can lead us to understanding why we didn't get anything close to 18 here.
Okay, that sounds useful.
Okay, so let's do that.